and good evening. The time is 3 minutes after 6 o'clock here from the beautiful campus of Alcorn State University. Glad you can join us on this Monday night. Here on the Jay Hopson Radio Show, some 48 hours following the Alcorn-USM game, a game that a lot of people are still talking about, and many folks are still steaming about 2 days after the fact. Charles Edmond here with our producer, Jamario Brooks, who's on one leg right now. He's got a little foot issue, but is here with us getting you all the phone calls and emails. I'm sure we'll have quite a few before this hour is said and done. Give us a call. We'd love to hear from you. 601-877-6595. 601-877-6595. Shoot us an email, football@alcorn.edu. We'll talk about that. Look at the SWAC games. The Braves got some votes for the FCS Top 25. We'll talk about that. And we'll preview Louisiana College, the Wildcats, coming up on High School and Community Colleges Day on Saturday at Sphinx Chasm Stadium, 2 o'clock kick. All right, Coach, good evening to you. How you doing?
Good evening, Charles.
Have you calmed down? Have you come down off of all the energy and emotion? That, you know, in doing games here as long as I have, there are certain games that will, I guess, fall into the memory bank of a lot of folks for a long time. And this is one of those games, considering how it ended and considering what took place.
Yeah, I told the team, I just got through talking to them. I said, hey, I'm gonna calm down when the radio show's done. I said when the radio show's done, I'm officially moved on. But definitely a tough loss with a lot of controversial issues. But it was at the end of the day too. We, despite some of the controversial issues, we still had our chances at the end to win the ball game. And of course we had a couple turnovers, 3 or 4 turnovers that you can't do against a good team. We knew. Southern Miss is a tough team. You know, they're an FBS school, so we knew going in it would be a tough ball game. We knew it would be a hard-fought ball game. We talked to the team. We thought it would be a four-quarter game, we knew it would be that type of game. At least that's what we expected, kind of the way it played out. And it was kind of playing into form. I thought we had the ball there with about 3 minutes to go on the drive. And again, that drive fittingly ended on another controversial call. So a lot of controversial calls, and it's certainly, it's one that we'll get over with. Like I said, today at 6:59, I'll move on, because one thing I learned from Coach Whitney is the biggest game is the next game.
Yeah.
And so, So what we'll do, we'll put it in the bank and go on, but that one hurt.
Well, you told Cedric Tillman after the game that, those calls, course, emotional after the game, but once you looked at the film and you have, what we'll do is we'll go through the highlights and we'll talk to you about those particular plays a little bit later as we go through the highlights. And let's get right to them, folks. 26,000 and change for the game on Saturday. The Braves won the toss, deferred to the second half. USM's first drive started at their own 25-yard line, picked up a first down, punted. The Braves' first drive of the game started at their own 15-yard line, trying to move the football early. Yep, the Braves were sharp early, first and 10 from USM's 33-yard line. After another Jarvis Turner 11-yard reception, the Braves were faced with a third and long and picked up the first, and the Braves first and 10 from USM's 18, and then it was third down and inches right here on highlight number two. Just what we didn't need.
Right, and we had 4 turnovers on the day, and you can't do that. And like we talked about. We still had a chance even after turning the ball over four times, but we can't do that and be successful. And Aaron's a young back, and he's going to be a really good football player at Alcorn, but big freshman mistake right there.
That was a 10-play, 77-yard drive. So USM started at their 8-yard line. There were a couple of face mask penalties on that drive, Jay Hopson, and the drive stalled at the Braves' 33-yard line, setting up an Acosta 50-yard attempt. So the Braves held for Jay Hopson down 3-0 despite the face mask penalties there.
Yeah, and the face mask, we had two, like you said, that's 30 yards, Charles. That's way too many. Of course, face, they were hustle plays. I thought defensively we played fast. I thought we played physical and we played fast. We still at times, you know what I'm saying, we got out of gap on a couple big runs they had. But I thought that drive really wasn't that bad of a drive except for the two face mask penalties, but they were hustle plays. Sometimes the hand just kind of gets caught in there on the face mask when you're hustling, trying to reach what you can to tackle, and just two unfortunate plays.
Well, the next Braves drive, after being down 3-0 on the first drive there by USM, the next drive, 3-and-out, so USM's next drive started at their own 19, and the first quarter ended on a Nick Mullins to Casey Martin 32-yard pass play. So, it was 3-0, Jay Hopson, at the end of the first 15 minutes.
Like we talked about, Charles, you know, when we go play in the FBS arena, you know what I'm saying, we have to start out fast and get the game moving and get it into the second half. And that's what we did. We came out, I thought we had some good defensive stops early. We moved the ball well on offense early. Just like I said, we had a couple penalties on that one drive that set up the long field goal. But, you know, pretty evenly matched first quarter. And I thought that's kind of how the game went. I thought Southern Miss got some big plays, bang, 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 in the second quarter. I thought the third quarter's kind of even. I thought we won the fourth quarter, but certainly an evenly matched game.
It was 3-0 at the end of one. We'll take our timeout right here, 10 minutes after 6 o'clock. We'll have the second quarter highlights coming up. Give us a call, 601-877-6595. A lot to talk about here on tonight's program, and we'll preview the Wildcats of Louisiana College a little bit later. We'll be back in 1 minute. You're listening live to the Jay Hopson Radio Show. Some calls they had replay and others they didn't. All right, back here live, 11 minutes after 6 o'clock here at Alcorn State University. They're putting up some portable stands over at Sphinx Castle Stadium across the way there, getting ready for some big home games coming up. Alabama State, Southern, and of course later on in the year, Jackson State, as we get ready for high school day on Saturday. All right, folks, let's get to the second quarter highlights. As we begin the second quarter, USM had a fourth down and one from the Braves' 9-yard line. So there were two flags on that play. The Braves were called for a face mask and then an illegal formation on the play, so we'll do it all over again. Emmanuel Barnes called that one three times and a great stance for the Braves.
That's right, Emmanuel's all over it. We had a really good, we had an inside backer stunt there and just really fit the gap tight and good and stopped them. You know, we kind of slammed it on that first fourth down and they gutted us there. But good stop, big stop by the defense, especially after the big play. And I thought we really played well down in the red zone.
And then following that, that's when things started getting interesting. Starting from this point on, after the defensive stance, the Braves took over with 13:40 left at the end of the first half at their 9-yard line, and they were faced with a second down and 5 from their own 14. What more can we say about that first question mark?
Well, and just went back and looked at it. Of course, that one is one that I really don't know, because on the film we had from the end zone angle, there's a number 7, I think, and the defense is just right in the way. So that one for me was hard to decipher and use. I'm only going to talk about the ones I feel confident in my soul that I know that I've seen and believe in. And so, big run by Rag. He showed a lot of explosiveness, showed breakaway speed that he has. You know, Rags gets in the open field, you're not going to catch him. I mean, he can roll. And I thought, he ran physical. He ran hard, I think Rags on his way to becoming a special, special player.
Not only did we not get the touchdown there, we were also called for it in sportsmanlike on that particular play.
Yeah, and one of our signalers, one of our young players that's one of our signalers, the official kind of grazed him running down. And, of course, he's out there with the coach and signaling. And, that's what it is. They called it, and, so we got to get him back.
So with that, the drive fizzled. The next USM drive started at their own 34 with 10:59 left. In the first half, it was 3-0 USM at that point. Still second down and 13, then third and 11. The Braves were offside. And then as the drive continued, it was fourth down and 3. There was a personal foul penalty called on Kedrick Taylor, so that kept the drive alive. First and 10 from ASU's 11, then second down and 6 from the Braves' 7.
Put me in my casket, Charles. They said, when you put old Coach Hop down, you bury him 6 feet under. He'll never concede that touchdown. I think when you stop the film, sometimes you can see he's trying to drag the foot and the ball is just like in the palm there, but he has no possession of the ball. And I went over that. I think I probably spent an hour just reframing. When he has possession, he's out of bounds in my book. And like I said, nobody will ever change that opinion as long as I live on this planet.
And then someone showed me, they pulled out the cell phone and showed a freeze frame of that. They showed his right foot was clearly out of bounds. The left foot was right there on the line. So, it was just another tough call, Jay Hopson. And what do you tell you? Despite all this that's going on, we had Rags there, you had the personal foul, now you have this. I mean, with 26,000 folks in the stands and a lot going on, as a player, how do you deal with that?
Well, it's part, we talked to them, it's part of the adversity of the game. You just got to keep fighting, and that's what I was proud of our players about. We did, and we're not the first team that's ever had a call that we didn't necessarily agree with, but at the end of the day, those are certainly two big plays, but like I said, the first one, I only can go with the film review that I have, but the first one, like I said, I'm not going to comment a lot on because I couldn't see, and maybe that was a correct call. But the second one, I had a great view of that and angled it. And I think it wasn't so much of the – I think the real question is when possession of the ball occurs. When possession, in my opinion, when possession occurred, he was out of bounds. You can stop the camera where it looks like the ball, is right there touching – fingertips, but it's not possessed, and that's what I kind of froze it at. And so you know, like I said, I mean, we could skill here until I can do this for another. If the good Lord puts me on this planet for another 40 years, my opinion will never change.
And then Andrew Kayla called for targeting. Did you see that?
To be honest with you, I disagreed with that too. You know, I mean, I thought he jumped in there. I don't know how you can target when you're jumping up in the air trying to bat down a pass. It'd be different. And usually when you're targeting, you're lowering your helmet trying to hit somebody. Hendrick was actually jumping up in the air to try to deflect the ball. And when he came down, when he landed down, he actually fell on the quarterback. So it really wasn't a violent hit. Then the quarterback fell down, of course. And then they called the 15-yard penalty that gave him the first. So, I have to say those two calls in that drive, I'm going to have to humbly say I didn't really agree with those two.
Well, it was 10-0 at that point. The Braves' next drive started at their own 25. Then on a 3rd and 6, John Gibbs was picked off by Kalen Reed at the Braves' 38. And then on the next play, Mullins to Ricard for 38 yards. It was 17-0 at that point, Jay Hopson. So despite everything, the turnovers really hurt.
Bang, bang. You know, that's what I told the team. I said, I told them at halftime, I think the score is 20-3, but I was like, guys, they really hadn't done much. It's just like bang, bang, in about a 50-second span, this went from a 3-0 game to a 17-0 game. And, we had the touchdown, and then we had the turnover, and then the quick bomb, you know. And so what happens is the whole complexion in that 1 minute went from a war to a 17-0 lead, where you would have thought if you looked at the scoreboard, well, Southern Miss is really in control doing things. But I think the one thing we tried to talk to our team about was really you just gave up a play. And one was kind of, one we'll talk about forever, but the other one, they did score on that long touchdown bomb. And I said, so you've got to just realize they're not really doing a whole lot to you. We just can't give up big plays, and we got to gain our composure and just get back in the game.
And the Braves did just that. The next ASU drive started at their 25, 2nd and 5. Gibbs a 32-yard scamper to the Golden Eagles 38. Then after a Ragsdale 5-yard run, the Braves had 2nd and 5 from the Golden Eagles 33. All Gibbs on that drive.
John did a great job on his reads and, just really big-time play, nice cutback against the grain, and just a play that we needed at that time to get us back in it.
And USM added a field goal late. So, Jay Hopson, you walk into the locker room, and it's 20-7 despite everything that's going on.
Really, yeah, and the last drive is probably the most disappointing drive to me of the first half when they drove down and kicked the field goal to get, the first one I thought was aided, and I'm not the first fade. We can talk about that forever, but we gave up the big play, which we don't want to give up big football plays. You can't do that against a really good opponent. But that last drive, I really thought, they stuck it to us on that last drive before the half. So we went in at halftime down 20-3, and I think we were pretty composed in the dressing room, and I think the team understood. And I think they all felt to a man that, we can beat this team. And one thing we talked about them, and we came out the second half saying, hey, we're the better team, and we got to come back and show them.
Yep, and it was 20-7 at the break. We'll take a timeout. The numbers statistically were about even when you look at it. Look at the third quarter highlights. When we come back, it's 21 minutes after 6 o'clock. The Jay Hopson Radio Show, a lot to chew on following the USM game on Saturday. We'll take a break and look at the second half highlights coming up in 1 minute. All right, 22 minutes after the hour here on the Jay Hopson Radio Show. look at the first half numbers, Jay Hopson, 199 yards at the half, 152 yards on the ground. John Gibbs, 47 yards passing the football. USM, 242. So the numbers, USM throwing it and the Braves running it.
Yeah, it was a pretty, even at the end of the game, it was pretty balanced. But the biggest thing was we gave them four turnovers, so they had more possessions. So that's probably why they had about 10 or 15 more yards at the end of the day, you know what I'm saying? But if we don't turn the ball over and give them those extra possessions, then I think we even win that battle, too, on top of it. Because, you know, we're going in to score, too. That's another 7 points that we didn't capitalize on.
Well, not much scoring in the third quarter. As we quickly recap it, the Braves got the ball to begin the third quarter. Jarvis Turner with a 19-yard reception on the first drive of the third quarter. The drive fizzled at USM's 48. The Golden Eagles' first drive of the second half started at their own 20. They went three and out, and after a 46-yard Sarazen punt, Anthony Williams Jr. fumbled, recovered by the Golden Eagles at the 26.
Yeah, Anthony, the ball kind of tailed on him a little bit, and he tried to go get it. And coming out, I thought we again established, like we did in the first half, that, hey, this was a back-and-forth game. They're stopping us, we're stopping them. But then again, it's just like the first touchdown they got. It was off a turnover. Now they get a punt fumble off a turnover. They hit the fade deep bomb off a turnover. We're giving the ball back deep inside our own territory, but the defense came in and stood up to the challenge.
Yeah, Costa's 23-yard field goal, despite the turnover, it was 23-7. So that was the score, Jay Hopson, at the end of three. And, you know, I was talking during the game about we were right on the edge of that cliff. You know, you get to the edge and the rocks start falling off the cliff and then you slide off the cliff. But somehow we pulled ourselves back in and got back in it.
No question. And I think the whole flow of the game was a battle. You know, I mean, it wasn't one of those games where, you know, to the novice fan, you could look at the score and say, oh, it's 23-7. But, you know, that was off. They had a big play, and then we had a huge turnover. We had two turnovers inside our territory that gave them points. And, we certainly had driven the ball the first series of the game to right there on the goal line to score and didn't score. And then we had a long drive to score. So, you know, we were giving them opportunities. We were going the long field, making our own opportunities. So, but from a coach's standpoint, we knew it was just a battle. You know, it was a war, and both teams were able to compete against each other pretty well.
Well, the stage is set for a frenetic fourth quarter, and we'll get to the highlights coming up in 1 minute. 601-877-6595. The Braves got back in the game and had a couple of cracks at it late. We'll talk about it with head coach Jay Hopson on the Jay Hopson Radio Show. We'll get to it in 1 minute on the Alcorn Football Radio Network. All right, welcome back. Before we go on with the fourth quarter highlights, we'll take our bottom of the hour break right now so we'll get through the highlights in the bottom of the hour. So let's pause 10 seconds for station identification. You're listening to the Alcorn Football Radio Network. Alcorn State University. Coming up, the fourth quarter highlights. Jay Hopson, we're right there, and we're right there to start this fourth quarter as we dig into the fourth quarter highlights. The Braves had 2nd and 7 from USM's 27, got to USM's 4, where it was 3rd and 1 from the Golden Eagles 4. Zarek Rollins in the game and in the Wildcat. Yeah. the first two games, Jay Hopson, we have called Casey Freeman's name quite a bit.
Casey's just done a tremendous job. He was actually our special teams player of the week this week, and did a tremendous job not only, you know, playing offense, but running down on punts, snapping, and just very multiple, versatile young player.
So it was at that point, it was 23-12, 13-14 left. And Jay Hopson, you went for two. Sent McRaney out wide and two-point conversion failed.
Yeah, it was 23-13, but we knew if we got the two, it would be 23-15. It would just be a one-possession ball game. So what we were trying to do is we were trying to get to an eight-point difference right there. So, we would have. He was walking in the end zone. He's horse-collared, and that's supposed to be a penalty. And, anybody can turn that film on and see that. And so, I mean, Zarek walks in the end zone, and we had just been penalized for a horse collar just probably 10 minutes earlier. And so what happens is he was grabbed from behind. And I'm, to be honest with you, I'm not a fan of the horse collar penalty. I don't really think it's a good penalty to call. But if it is a rule, that's exactly what happened to Zarek. So without the horse collar, he walks in, and now it's 23-15.
So, wow, so the Braves get back in it, 23-13 at that point. So USM's next drive started at their 15-yard line, got to the Braves 49, and it was a third down and seven in this situation. Third and seven right here. Big third down coming up. That was Mullins to D.J. Thompson. That was a big play in that fourth quarter.
Yeah, and, the good thing, they got the first, but we were able to stop them and force them into a field goal situation, which still kept it at a two-score ball game, and that's what we had to do. So didn't want to give up the first, but then again, hey, at least we gave up the field goal, and that was critical, just keeping it within reach.
You have to give the defense a lot of credit. They only had two touchdowns in the game, four field goals. So the D, when they had to man up, they did.
They did, and the D was in a couple tough situations. You know, you had a couple turnovers that led to. As a matter of fact, it might even be two. I know that led to points, maybe 10 points. So they were backed up at times, and they did a great job. Of course, the punt return, so it'd be three, and they did a good job of slamming the door on them.
So the Braves are still within striking distance. Once again, at the edge of that cliff, couldn't quite get off of it a little bit, as it was 26-13 with 9:10 left. So ASU's next drive started at their 23, 9:10 remaining, and they were faced with a fourth down and two from USM's 31, probably with the game hanging in the balance right here. Talk about the decision to go for it right there.
Charles,
the riverboat gamble.
Yeah, we're playing to win.
Yeah.
I mean, so at the end of the day, I think we're down to what is 7 minutes, 8 minutes. I felt like if we punted and all they had to do was get a first down and they could run off about 4 minutes of the clock and stuff. And we didn't come not to win. And so, I just felt like, hey, we got to go for it because, like I said, if we punt it back to them and they do get one first down, that usually drains about 4 minutes off. And then being down two scores, you pretty much have sealed your fate.
So the Braves finally get on the board with John Gibbs setting up that score, and the Braves taking full advantage. Yep, and that was exactly how it happened. 26 to 20, Jay Hopson, 7.5 minutes left. So let's buckle up here, and as we get down the stretch, USM started at their own 25-yard line, picked up a first down, then punted. So it was first down and 10 for the Braves at their own 20-yard line. What looked like a 5 or 6 yard loss turned out to be a 35-yard gain.
Really, really, really impressive run by Rags. You know what I'm saying? Like I said, he did that all himself, and then they picked up a block. I can't remember who it was. Maybe Reno, if I'm not mistaken, but just did a great job turning nothing into something on that play.
So now the Braves are in business. The 35-yard run, first and 10 from the Golden Eagles 45. Then we had a third down and 5 from USM's 40. We see that. I've seen running backs get to the quarterback trying to get the play, and most of the time that doesn't happen, but it happened right there.
Right, we just got to get lined up. You know, it's something to train to be the first to tell you. You know, we got to get lined up, and it's, I think John then kind of looked over, started talking to train, and then that's when Skelly snapped the ball, you know what I'm saying? So it's we just had a little miscommunication, and we can't do that. You know, so that goes down to my execute what we always talk about. You know, we have to execute at a high level, especially when you're playing a top opponent on our schedule like Southern Miss, you know. So it's a big misalignment, misassignment, which puts us in fourth and long. And we actually had a misread on second down, which could have prevented us from even being in that situation. We could have moved the chains on second down had we made the right read. But it's football, those things do happen, but it's fourth down, and now we've got to convert.
Yeah, fourth down and 11 from USM's 46. After Jay Hopson's
first review. I agree with Emmanuel on a lot of Emmanuel's calls. I think we need to have a couple calls because I'm in firm agreement with a lot of his calls. You can't hit the receiver 5 yards before the ball gets there. I don't care what you're doing. And you can sit there and say, he's making a play on the ball or he's doing this. I mean, he ran right through our receiver. And the ball wasn't even close. I mean, the ball was just crossing line of scrimmage. Our receiver's 10 yards downfield, and they've run through our receiver. I mean, they knocked Jordan completely down. And so, I mean, again, that's another one you can put me in my casket. The day I die, I'll never believe that's not pass interference, you know. So, I mean, if I'm the back judge, I'm calling it every time. So it is what it is.
Wow. So when you look at it, Jay Hopson, in this situation, the Braves had a couple of chances in this game to really make an impact. Got the ball twice in the last 5 minutes. Just talk about the opportunity to at least get the ball back late and with a chance to make something happen.
You know, we had our chances to win the game, and that's the one thing that I addressed to the team. You know, certainly anybody that can turn on the TV can argue a lot of the controversial issues. You know what I'm saying? That'll be there forever, but the point we made to the football team was, you know, we can't get caught up in that. We had our opportunities, like I said, a misread here, an execution there. We don't put ourselves in that fourth down situation, you know what I'm saying? We hold on to the ball going in to score earlier. We don't put it on the ground at the 7 yard line in the first quarter. That's another 7 points. We're up 27-26 with the ball. So, I mean, there's so many things you could look to, you know, I mean, and that's kind of the way I address the football team. You know, there's going to be a lot of people tell you over the next so often, well, y'all got this, you got, you know, you should have, you know. But at the end of the day, you know, we have to realize we've got to take it out of the officials' hands, too, and execute and do the things that we can do to make sure that we win the ball game. And we did, and we turned the ball over too much. You know, and that's just the simple fact. And I guess, like I said, a quality opponent like Southern Miss, you can't do that. And but we fought, and we played fast. I thought we were physical. You know, we made plays. We did a lot of good things in the game. We gave ourselves that opportunity to win the game. And I thought, like everybody thought, well, we're going to win it now. And we got the ball back with about, what was it, 4 minutes to go in that last drive. I thought, well, we're winning this one, you know. And so, you know, and I was kind of like Emmanuel in that last play. You know what I'm saying? I was kind of screaming down the sidelines, too, a little bit. You know what I mean? That was interference. But, you know, it is what it is. It's a hard-fought game. It was a tough one to swallow. It's a tough one on Saturday night. So I think I got in bed about 3:30, 4 o'clock. And that's just natural when you lose a hard-fought, tough game. But the one thing, you know, I hope, you know, we just, you know, we'll continue to play those FBS games. And that's kind of where we want to kind of build our program, just as a measuring stick to let everybody know we can play on the highest level of college football. You know what I'm saying? We know FCS has got a lot of really good football teams, but we want to let people know, too, we can not only play on FCS level, we can also play on that FBS level. And, you know, we don't mind playing SEC, but, you know, hey, if I can get them, I want to play them, you know. And I think we're working on another team from a major BCS conference. And so hopefully we'll get that game and, you know, just everybody knows the Braves are going to come. We're going to come play for 60 minutes.
Well, you talked about the officiating. Let's put a cap on this. And this is an obvious question, probably an obvious answer. Did the officiating take the luster off what turned out to be a great game?
Well, this is the thing. And like I said, as a football coach, we're always going to have those games where, you think, man, that was a rough officiated game. But they're human beings like we are, too. You know, these are the facts. And all I do, I'm one of those guys, I look at the film. Like I said, I didn't really comment after the game. I told them, I want to look at the film.
Yeah.
You know, before I make a statement, because I don't want to come in here and just bash officials, because the worst job I ever had was a little league umpire when I was 17 years old. So I understand a little bit of that. But the, you know, the facts are after watching the film, and all I can do is answer openly and honestly. You know what I'm saying? Do I think the fade was a touchdown? No. Do I think there was a horse collar on the two-point conversion? Yes. Do I think that was pass interference? Yes. Did I agree with the targeting? No. You know what I'm saying? Did I, you know, I mean, I couldn't tell on the long run just because from the film I had from the end zone, you know, there's somebody blocking. So I don't even issue that. I'm taking that he did. So I heard somebody tell me that, they thought he did, so that's fine. But the ones that I argue with, the ones I clearly can see and the things that I clearly believe in my mind is that it is what it is. But, you know, and those are game-changer moments. But like I said, our job, too, as a football team is, and somebody can say, oh, that fade is 7 points, that two-point conversion is 9 points. You know, even if you stop the touchdown, they kick the field goal, it's still a six-point swing. You lost by six. But then we still had the opportunity to, and who knows if they would make it. But then you have the opportunity to go in and score when you're inside the 10. You got to take advantage of that opportunity. You know, the last drive, if we get the interference call, do I believe that was interference? Yes, I do. If we get that, then I think maybe we continue on and get that last score and win the ball game. But the thing, you know, losses always hurt. They're always tough to accept. But, you know, one thing that is, you know, I think we can walk into home now and sit and talk to a young man and let them know that our program is of the same quality of Conference USA schools, because we've proven it on the football field. So I think that is in Southern Miss, you know, they had Middle Tennessee and some of those schools that they played, those were battles. So it's not like, we know they've lost a few games of late, but they've competed and they beat UAB at the end of the season last year by about 35 points. So hopefully we can use this kind of as anything, just a kind of a tool just to let the young student athletes in the state of Mississippi know that we are Division I, and we can compete on the FBS and the FCS level, and that's what we want to do. You know what I'm saying? As we continue to build our program, That's what it's all about, you know, just laying those bricks down. And we know it's a marathon, not a sprint. You know, anytime you're building a program and you're trying, you know, we're trying to make that step and we're trying to get bigger and get better and do those things. And you know, it's just part of that journey. But I couldn't be prouder of the guys. I tell you, those players in that locker room, they love the purple and gold now. There's a lot of Alcornites in that dressing room that they'll be back here when they're 90 years old because they truly love Alcorn. They fought hard for their Alcorn, and they fought hard for their school. And that was one of the things that we talked to them on Friday night about. And I was proud of them, and I was proud of the effort. I mean, I thought we played aggressive, we played fast, and just didn't execute offensively and defensively at times like I wish we would have in a couple situations.
We're going to go inside the numbers, and you brought up a good point about recruiting and how a game like this plays into recruiting. I want to ask you about that. When we come back, we'll take a break here. 43 minutes after 6 o'clock here on the Jay Hopson Radio Show. We'll take this break, and we'll be right back on the Alcorn Football Radio Network. All right, well, with our producer, Jamario Brooks, Charles Edmond, 44 minutes after 6 o'clock. Jay Hopson, let's go inside the numbers here. 295 yards rushing. Did you think you'd have that type of success when you looked at USM a week ago against Mississippi State?
Well, you know, you never know going into a game. And like I said, and we are a balanced football team, you know, and that's what we try to do, rushing and passing. We want to do the same, but we hit some big runs. And that's just like, I think the first week we had a lot of rushing yards because we got up real early, and so we just ran the ball in the second half, you know. I think this game, John made some huge runs, Rag made some long runs, and we just had some big plays in the running game, which was good to see.
John Gibbs, I thought he was going to have 200 yards rushing in the football game. I mean, he was really approaching that 161 as it turned out, but he was on his way to a 200-yard game, I thought.
Yeah, John opens up, you know. John can really run, I thought really did a good job on some of our zone read and power read stuff, but he'll be the first to tell you, too, a couple of those passes he wishes he could have back, you know what I'm saying? So it's I thought John did a good job, made huge plays for us, and just he's done a tremendous job since he's been here.
Early in the game, especially on that first drive, Jarvis Turner, who finished with 4 receptions, looked great. Then overall, I thought we had some drop balls.
We did, Charles. I think you're right on there. We had a lot of drops on third down too that could have moved this change. You know, that's something we talked to the receivers about today. You know, when you get those opportunities on third and six, and you know we got an opportunity to move those stakes, we got to do it because now we're just handing the ball back to the offense, and that's the thing. We've got to come out this week, and we got to execute on a higher level than we did against Southern Miss, and that's what I want to see these guys do.
Defensively, Damian Watkins with 13 tackles and Devon Francois with 12 tackles for the Braves.
Yeah, I thought both guys played fast and physical. Damian was actually our defensive player of the game, but I thought defensively as a whole, I thought we tackled pretty well. Like I said, I thought we played physical and fast. A couple times we got out of gap on a couple long runs that they had, and that's something that we can't do, you know, especially against a big-time opponent or FBS opponent.
There was a lot of cramping out there, and despite
shocked
that.
Shocked me. Yeah, that shocked me. I mean, because that's the first time I'd seen us do that. And, I thought we're going to load up with some more power in on Friday night because that's the first time that I felt like we really had a bunch of guys cramping, you know, and I don't know if it was the asphalt on that, you know, that rubbery, I don't know if it was the turf, you know, because sometimes you put the thermometer on that turf right there, it gets up to about 139. Of course, we practice on the ground.